Happy holidays from the Behind the Bells podcast.
Marker and action.
This is Behind the Bells, the show that takes you behind the magic of your favorite Christmas movies and shows. Within the background of every Santa Claus, reindeer, and stocking is a story. Where did it come from? Our Christmas movie expert will unravel all of that and give you the full story. Sit back and enjoy another episode with Robert Nicholas.
Merry Monday, everyone, and welcome to Behind the Bells. I'm your host, Robert Nicholas, and I'll be taking you on another one-horse open sleigh ride into the world of Christmas movies. I've thought about doing an episode on this, but now that I've actually seen today's particular movie, it's not worth a deep dive. In fact, I'm not even sure if it's worth even doing an episode of because I feel like I'm drawing attention to it, but I know I'm gonna get chastised if I don't talk about it. So let's talk about Home Sweet Home Alone. I'm not alone on this one. I've actually got not one, not two, but three specific podcasters. So let's go ahead and bring them all in. First, we have our first, but not best. We have CJ from Christmas Conversations.
You just say first, but not best. Thanks, Robert. How's it going, man?
Good.
Thanks for having me on. I'm pretty good, man. Thanks for having me on your first podcast, I guess, with multiple guests. I don't know why you picked this group, but you're about to earn your money, pal.
Oh, I'm definitely going to. I really want to get my money's worth off of this. Okay, next from Tis the Podcast, we have a third of the team with us. We have Anthony.
Thanks for having me, Robert. You also have the best of the team here.
All right. I'm looking forward to that. I'm really going to want to hear your thoughts on this because I didn't get a chance to listen to the Tis the Podcast episode on Home Sweet Home Alone. But after everything I've been seeing on social media, I really want to listen to that now.
I'm excited to talk about it. So,
all right. And then finally, for our third guest, we have from Feliz Navidad, Manny.
What? It's Feliz Christmas, Merry Navidad.
All right, you just did it better than I did. You can have my job now.
It's a tongue twister.
Oh, definitely.
It's way too long of a name.
Yes.
Okay, so before I get into the whole Home Sweet Home Alone disaster piece that it is, first of all, why don't we go into exactly just our general opinion on the first Home Alone movie. And I'll just say right now, it is my number one favorite Christmas movie above everything else, above It's a Wonderful Life, above Jingle All the Way, above Elf. And yeah, I'm sure there's at least one person out there that likes Jingle All the Way as their number one movie. So kudos to them. But yeah, the original Home Alone means a lot to me. It's the very first movie I actually still have memories of seeing in a movie theater, even though I was just 3 years old.
My first memory actually of Home Alone 1 is being in Montreal. I was visiting family, and I think it came out in what, 91? Did it come out?
1990.
Yeah. Okay. So I was young. I was around 5 years old, but I still have this memory of being in, you know what? It might have been 91. It was the year before because it was out on VHS, I believe. Mm-hmm. So I was watching it on VHS in Montreal, and it was the first time I watched it. And I was like, this is incredible. I absolutely love it. Like, it was everything you wanted to do as a kid. I mean, you didn't want to be, you know, surrounded by criminals, but you would have loved to like use all these tricks and different paint cans. And I just remember as a kid, it was like everything you could ever dream of. But yeah, the first time I seen it, I was in Montreal around 91 and it was on VHS. And I probably watched it like, oh, I don't know, 10 times while I was there. So, and I my mom always said I would quote it like constantly, nonstop. So that's when I first seen part one.
All right, Manny, what about you?
All right, so I saw the second one before the first one. And years after, I realized, I mean, I was too young to actually do some research. And when I saw the first one, I fell in love with that movie. I mean, it's like CJ said, it's everything you want to be as a kid. You know, want to be able to do a bun- a bunch of that stuff. That's basically how I got my love for cheese pizza.
Hey, fellow cheese pizza fan here too.
And yeah, I mean, that's a movie that I grew up with. I do play it all year round. The first one more than the second one. So, and I still quote it, you know, annoy my wife a little bit, but I enjoy it. I still enjoy it to this day.
All right, good. All right, Anthony, bring us home.
I don't have a long history with this film because I did not watch this film as a child. I only saw this film for the first time when I was in university.
What?
As a child, it just didn't appeal to me. As a child, I preferred the Santa magical elf type thing. So, like, I had no interest in this movie about this little kid taking on robbers. But then when I watched it in university with a friend, I fell in love with the movie, immediately watched the second one. It's funny because the first Home Alone movie I ever saw as a kid was Home Alone 3. So
at least connected to the first one.
So I didn't see Home Alone 1 and 2 till college, but I love them. They're Home Alone. They're both in like my top 10 Christmas films of all time. Home Alone 1 is probably in top 3, top 4. It's a classic, you know. It doesn't feel like Christmas until I see Kevin McAllister beating the crap out of the Wet Bandits.
Exactly, because I think any kid watching the original Home Alone just feels, you know, much more empowered than they would be for a lot of other movies. considering that, I mean, even though I'm sure this is not the first time a kid has ever had to defend himself against adults, Home Alone was certainly probably one of the first like major hit movies that, you know, by, if you remember the 1990s, we ended up getting a lot of duplicate movies that attempted the same kind of trope of kids having to fend off adults with pranks or traps.
And a lot of duplicate movies in the sense that a lot of films took on that over-the-top slapsticky, violent, in quotes, humor, whether it's the same premise with the kid taking on adults or just adults taking on adults.
Oh yeah, because I will admit that one I definitely rewatched a lot, even though I know the movie's no good, is the original Three Ninjas movie.
Oh yeah, that one was fantastic. As a kid though, like that was perfect too. It definitely was on the same track as Home Alone. But I remember leaving the theater watching Three Ninjas with my uncle, and at the time they had them in the mall. So we were walking through, I don't know what it was, some kind of clothing store, the Bay. We have the Bay in Canada. I don't know if you have it there, but I just remember trying to do karate moves on all the mannequins. And my uncle's just like, can you stop, man? Yeah. Like it definitely has that same feel, but yeah, when you're a kid, you want to beat up adults, man. Like, don't you remember Power Rangers, the putties? Every kid thought they could whoop a putty, but a putty would probably whoop us. You know what I mean?
Don't you remember Jingle All the Way, the putties, where Turbo Man took on the putties and
yeah.
Whatever the dude's name, the Dementor. Yeah.
Dementor and his go demon team. I think that was what it was.
You're my number one customer.
So clearly Home Alone was Chris Columbus's dry run for Jingle All the Way.
Probably. I mean, the guy ended up producing several other Christmas movies, including Christmas of the Cranks. I mean, I don't know how much of a hand he had in that one, but it's clear that he kept really, I don't want to say riding off the success of Home Alone, but I think he just knew that that was just something he was at least good at, telling a good Christmas story. And he just thought he could capture that same lightning in a bottle multiple times. And it just so happened that he didn't, but you know, in a way, he's still trying exactly. to. Well, because he still is trying with those Christmas Chronicle movies, which, you know, I will admit, while I don't love those movies, you know, I do enjoy watching them whenever they're on.
Yeah, where's the third one?
That's what I'm wondering. And of course, with the second one that came out last year, I was kind of hoping I could catch the second one in theaters since a few Cinemark theaters played it. But here in Southern California, we don't have that many Cinemark theaters.
It's actually crazy because I was expecting big things from the second Christmas Chronicles, but I don't know, something about it I just didn't like. I like part one. Part two had some good parts to it, but yeah, I'm willing to watch a three, but it's by no means is it part of my Christmas canon.
There was something about it you didn't like. Was it the bad CGI elves? Was it Mrs. Claus being a Halloween witch? Was it Belschnickel looking like Manny?
Oh man.
I love you, Manny.
That's messed up. That's
what was it? Belsnickel from Christmas Chronicles 2. He plays what's his name in Deadpool 2? Oh my
god. Fire Fist.
Yeah, there you go. So yeah, Belsnickel, that actor, I've seen him on quite a bit of different movies lately.
I think he killed his career in Christmas Chronicle 2, by the way.
No.
I think so.
He made a comeback in Godzilla versus Kong.
Oh, yeah. He wasn't that. He was a podcast kid, right?
Yeah.
Or at least the fan of podcast.
Yeah.
Listen, if The Rock could survive Doom, anybody could survive any box office blunder, okay?
Okay, but anyway, going back to the whole Home Alone trope, Chris Columbus earlier this year, before the movie even came out, derided the idea of a remake of Home Alone in general because he felt like there was no way it was ever going to live up to the first one. But here's my question for everybody. Would it have been possible to even remake Home Alone better than the original?
No.
No. And I would say no. And I'm not even, it's not even because of nostalgia. I just think that Christmas films, a lot like comedy, it comes in different waves and it's always changing and it's always adapting. So I think to do what they did back in 1990, not even as far as the premise goes, like all it would take now, like the famous meme say, is like a text message or something like that. But as far as just all the silly things, I just don't know how they do it now, because like in comedy, like one thing that always sticks with comedy is delivery. Delivery is always funny, but then sometimes you have the blatant jokes, the rude jokes, and then it comes in waves. You can do it and you can't do it. As far as this movie goes, doing that over the top criminal idiots, like it's just not in right now. And I think that's what glared in this one. And they tried to change it by them, I guess it's spoiler alert, not technically being criminals or just trying to find. For me, I don't know how they could make it now and make it good. No, I think it was perfect for his time. I don't think they could do it now. And they proved it. It sucked. I'm not sure if that was the question you're asking, but I'm just ready to rip this movie apart.
It can't be remade. It was a specific period in time, like CJ said. And it was lightning in a bottle. They had the perfect cast. They were viewed as the underdog at the time. The initial studio tried to cancel the film when they got another studio to pick them up. Mm-hmm. Nobody thought it would be a success. And that worked in its favor. They were able to like, okay, we have a small budget. No one has faith in us. Let's just go for it. And they did. And it worked. And I'm with CJ too. Like, nobody wants to see the goofy criminals nowadays. Maybe they should have got Robert De Niro to play the criminal. That's who they wanted in Joe Pesci's place. And that would have been a completely different, scarier movie if he was one of the Whip Bandits. Maybe they should have had a more serious take if they were going to remake it. Who knows?
Yeah, but if we would have brought in De Niro, then we wouldn't have had the live action Yosemite Sam the world has been asking for.
all I know is this movie, which I agree sucked, this movie tried so hard. They bent over backwards to try to be like, hey, this works nowadays. See, but no, I didn't believe it worked. I didn't believe the kid wouldn't go next door and call the cops. I didn't believe that he wouldn't go outside when the cop is out. I just didn't believe any of it. It didn't work for me. Any of it.
Now to actually get our initial, well, at least we'll ask him when he gets back, but for our initial thoughts on the remake, if you had to rate it 1 out of 10, I'm kind of taking a little bit from Tis the Podcast here, but rating system from 1 to 10, what would you rate Home Sweet Home Alone?
Are we allowed to rate it 0?
Yeah, you can give it a 0 if you want. You can even give it a negative number if you want.
I wouldn't give it a negative number. I would just call it a fat 0. It just was not good. There was no redeeming qualities in it. It was not a good film. If anybody asked me, should I watch this? I would just say no. Like, don't.
All right, Anthony?
I'm going to give it a 0.1.
0.1, okay.
It's not as bad as Kirk Cameron Saving Christmas.
All right, and
so wait, what would you give it on a scale of 1 to 10, Robert?
All right, well, maybe it's because I do have a soft spot because I've worked on a lot of other like small scale short film sets or so, and I know the work that goes into it. I'm going to give this a very, very generous 2.
You know what I'll say? You know what I'll say about it? I mean, obviously it was Disney Plus production, whatever it was. Like, the production quality was beautiful in it. It was like great scenery, well shot. Like, I'm not hating on that. It's just the story in itself. And
Disney didn't cheap out on the production like they did with Noel.
Hey, who shit on it?
No, I said Disney didn't cheap out on the
production. Oh, I thought you said somebody. Oh, yeah. Somebody. I thought Noel wasn't too bad. I mean, yeah, it did rely a lot on CGI, but I for the most part, like, the good thing I will say about the new Home Alone is it looked really nice. I mean, the quality is fantastic, and I even love Ellie Kemper, but she couldn't even save this for me. Just
Well, because one thing I will say though that even though the film does look good, I actually would say that's a fault against it this time, because when I really compare it to the original Home Alone. That the original Home Alone just felt so warm. And, you know, I mentioned in my podcast that Columbus really wanted to ensure that the colors red, green, or white would appear in every sequence, really giving it kind of a timeless feel to the whole thing. And yet, with the new movie, even though it shot well, I mean, with the right money, you could shoot any movie well. And that's not to say that the movie here isn't shot well, but to me, I guess it's almost shot as well as a high budget Hallmark movie. I mean, it looks nice, but there's really nothing here to really distinguish it as a Home Alone movie either.
So yeah, I want to piggyback off a few things you said. One, I've seen better Hallmark movies than this film. And that's saying something, because I don't have a love for Hallmark. Two, about the house. Yes, 100%. This was not a warm, like, the house had no personality at all. And, like, when you go back to the original, the house was a character in itself. But this house, and I get it, that was the joke, right? That they make the joke in the film, like, oh, houses are so cookie cutter nowadays. We even broke into the wrong house. But I don't want to watch a film about that. The house, if you're the criminal's house that they're trying to save, has more personality than the house they break into. And I get it, that was the point, right? But then don't spend half of your film breaking into this house that I don't want to spend time in.
I want to go back to what you said, Robert, just to kind of touch on the first film one more time. There was one part that always bugged me about the original film. It's just like a nitpicky thing. But anytime I watch it with my wife or my kids, when he's taking the sled down the stairs, scientifically, the way you look, it is not happening. It does not line up with the door. There's no chance he's going out that door when he's going down those stairs. I'm sorry. It's just no way. Even if you angled it, it just always bugged me. Did anybody else notice that too? Or am I just ridiculous?
No, I noticed that too, but I try not to think too hard about the science of that film, considering the fact, you know, that wet bandits would have been dead 5 minutes after trying to break into this house.
Oh, for sure.
Oh, you would have brought the Mythbusters onto this movie. The whole thing would have been canceled within 10 minutes.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, but just that one scene would always bug me. I don't know why. It just didn't make sense.
Yeah, but actually, I guess it didn't really bother me that much as a kid, because usually I would tell people, I would usually quote Johnny Depp by saying, "What do you know? Haven't you heard of suspension of disbelief?"
Well, hey, I'm a wrestling fan. That's what I live for, I guess, watching that stuff.
Yeah, but to be fair, even on the commentary for Home Alone on the Blu-ray, Chris Columbus admits that it didn't match up well, and they just decided, I don't think people will think too hard.
Yeah.
Only and here comes CJ.
Yeah, and then there's me. But did you guys watch the movies that made us on it? I thought that was really interesting. There was a lot of stuff I did not know about it. It was basically,
I love that whole series.
Yes. Yeah, it was like filmed in a gymnasium, the basement part, I think, with all the water and stuff. And it was filmed in like a gymnasium pool or something. It was very cool, man.
Yeah, because they used two different gyms at two different high schools outside of the Chicago area. In fact, I actually ended up getting a lot of information that ended up in the podcast. Like, I actually didn't even know Daniel Stern was initially fired from the movie.
Yeah, that was interesting too. And since you brought up, like, since we're on your podcast and brought it up, like, I've listened to your podcast a few times, man, and I got to give you kudos. It's well put together. It seems super professional, and you're doing a good job, man.
Hey, maybe
I should have said that. I should have said it at the end, but no, like, I was even talking to Anthony when we're talking about coming on, and we both agreed that, like, production quality, like, it's fantastic, man.
Yeah, thanks. I always appreciate that, dude.
No worries.
But yeah,
CJ just spoke for me, but yes, agreed.
I can see that.
And then there's Manny. He's probably never even listened. He doesn't listen to anybody else's podcast.
I listen to everybody's podcast, but I do it while I'm working. So it's usually like this headphone on and everybody's talking. I use it as background noise. So it's,
Robert was asking us when you got disconnected. I mean, you're the host, Robert. Ask him, I guess, that you know the question.
Okay. Taking a cue from Tis the Podcast, on a scale of 1 to 10, or a 0 if you want, what would you give Home Sweet Home Alone?
I would actually give it a 3.
Okay, so you're the highest so far.
I mean, let me explain that 3. I mean, the movie is horrible. The actor, the kid that they got for it, you know, he's a good actor. They wasted really good acting from him in this movie. Like he has so much potential, and they have him starring in this piece of garbage.
He does have a lot of potential. Did you see Jojo Rabbit with him?
No.
Great in it. That's a great movie. But after watching this film, I hope he goes the way of what's his name? Little Anakin Skywalker, who never got like another gig.
I know who you're talking about. Jake Lloyd.
Jake Lloyd. That's the way I hope he goes. Chris Columbus can destroy another career. Although Phantom Menace came after Jingle All the Way, so never mind.
That's true,
Robert though. Is like a film encyclopedia.
He is, yeah.
It's crazy. In fact, speaking of child actors, here's my next question. Where do you think they went wrong with Archie Yates that went so well for Macaulay Culkin?
He's not likable. And I know he can play likable. I think it is the script. I think a lot of the problems of this film boils down to the writing. Because I know this kid is talented. I agree with Manny. I've seen him in other things, and he's not a bad child actor. But, like, he's a jerk. Kevin McAllister was not a jerk, ultimately. And Macaulay Culkin had this cute innocence built in. I would say also there was a problem. It goes back to you should have cast the part younger. They wrote it too old.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if I think there was like 3 writers in the film or so, or 2 writers. I didn't really check on that. In fact, actually, I got the little thing right here. Okay, it was 2 writers and 3 people that worked on the story. 2, because John Hughes is credited, even though it's just a celebratory credit. But it makes me wonder if they really did not, you know, watch any other movies, or especially something like Jojo Rabbit, to get an understanding on just how a kid, what kind of snarky kid would he be at that specific age? Because when I think about Macaulay Culkin, with the way he first snarked at his mother by saying, "Hang up the phone and make me, why don't you?" I mean, even though I probably would have been smacked had I said that, I still could have seen myself at 8 years old saying that to, you know, a teacher or something. John Hughes just really understood the exact kind of snarkiness an 8-year-old would have had. Our 2 writers here clearly do not. I think they just pretty much thought, well, what exactly would have we have said at that age that would have been just as snarky or funny, unaware that maybe this is just something that the kids obviously wouldn't be able to relate to in this character. Which I am curious to see exactly how a lot of kids would respond to this kid now.
This movie lacked Catherine O'Hara.
And
any warmth and emotion that came between her reunion and the kids' reunion at the end of the movie, it did not do anything for me at the end of this film. Number one. Number two, bit of trivia for you since you're a movie buff.
Mm-hmm.
What movie made John Hughes the most money in his career?
101 Dalmatians.
Yes. Did you listen to that in the episode? You heard that in Tis the Podcast?
So that's a point.
Yeah. 101 Dalmatians is that back-end merchandising money. The live-action 101 Dalmatians. Who would have thunk it?
So Robert's a movie freak like CJ's a wrestling freak. That's awesome.
Oh, yeah. That's probably why I'm probably the only guy so far that ever did a deep dive into Ernest Saves Christmas.
That was amazing. But I was going to go back to what you said when you were talking about their writing of Macaulay Culkin or Kevin. What you said about what 8-year-olds would say, and I always love the line because it's something I would have said as a kid, is when she's like, "I want you to go upstairs. I don't want to see you for the rest of the night." He's like, "Good, because I don't want to see you again for the rest of my entire life." I was like, it's such a thing that I would have said as a kid, and it's my favorite line out of all the Home Alone movies, man. So yeah, what you said is true there. But just to touch on the difference, I think Anthony nailed it. I just don't think he's likable. I think he was miscast. I think he should have been a bit younger. and I don't know, a little bit less English, maybe. I don't know. Maybe I'm like my wife. Sometimes, like when I hear English actors in the middle with, I guess, American actors, like I just didn't understand the whole dynamic. People were like, oh, what does it matter? It's like, I don't know. I don't know why it just bothered me. I didn't like the casting. And I don't know. You could edit that out if I sound a bit like an a-hole, but like, I don't know. His mom was English, but he wasn't raised in England, right?
Wait, he was. So this is this is part of my problem. Say mentioned in the film, they just moved there 2 months ago, which is why they don't know any neighbors, right? Don't believe this kid wouldn't go next door and call police or something, call his mom, whatever. And I'll tell you why. Like, if they were going to make them foreign, they should have made them, you know, a minority, not a white person, not from an English speaking country, like an English speaking country movie, obviously, but like, not like a minority that would have had would have made more sense. Like, oh, you don't know anyone in the neighborhood. They're more outsiders. They're not going to go next door and knock like that. What they could have had an interesting commentary on that. But instead they made them English for no reason other than, we have to come up with some way why this kid isn't going to go next door and call the cops. Oh, they don't know the neighbors. They're English. They just moved in. Well, why didn't you just have them move in from across the country? Why did the English thing served no point?
To be fair, I came in a little later because my wife and kids had started watching it. So I missed about the first 15 minutes. So if they said that within the first 15 minutes, that's why. But I think it would have been cool to get like a minority in there. But I don't know, if I were the robbers, I'd probably be more scared of like an African-American mother, because if that kid destroyed the house like that, the robbers, whether they're nice or not, they're getting whooped. The kid's getting whooped. Like, that would have been a way better movie, man, because if you're going to damage an African-American mom's house like that, man, you're going to get whooped. There's no way around it. That movie is going to end with somebody getting their ass kicked.
No, you know what would have been a better movie? If the family would have been like from Vietnam, like they would have had some wealthy family from Vietnam moving in, the kid gets left home alone, and yet the robbers coming in are like both Vietnam veterans, and they start having post-traumatic stress going out.
Oh, my God, yeah. That would be a totally different lane they would go down. Like, that'd be great.
But yeah, of course, one of the reasons they obviously made the family English was to allow the excuse to cover up this plot hole of trying to find a way to make sure this kid wouldn't go next door or go on the internet or something like that. But again, I would think they would have at least known about, or at least the parents would have at least known about an app like Patch or something, so that way they could have at least gone to the neighbor to say on this whole like database, listen, we got a kid at home. Can just one person please just go over there until we get back there or so?
Exactly.
With the way technology is, like, for example, around my house, you walk around, it says if it's a dog, if it's a person walking or whatever, like all these freaking sensors and stuff with the technology, and those people with, you know, that big house. And so the parents don't even know what the heck is happening. So they don't have a way to check on the house when they're away. Like, what the heck? Is, you know, 2021, man.
Exactly. I mean, this is clearly a stupid story written by stupid people who attempted to do one smart thing, which is the next thing I want to get into, switching the subjective so that rather than the narrative focusing on the kid, we now have the narrative that's focusing on the bandits trying to subvert the expectations. So
you thought that was a smart move they made? I have to disagree because it doesn't work. They can't have their cake and eat it too. If you're going to have us sympathize with the bandits, you can't have the crap be out of them. Because if you want me to sympathize with them, I don't want to watch them have the crap be out of them. If you want me to like them.
And they're horrible.
And they are horrible. And okay, can we talk about the writing for a minute?
Of course.
First of all, they make the wet bandits look competent. Number one. Mm-hmm. Number two, talk about the writing. The first one, you could say it's not the most intelligent movie, but at least it didn't devolve into fart jokes. There's a literal moment where the husband farts on the wife, and we're supposed to find that funny.
I find you funny explaining that.
I'm sorry. Like, excuse me. Am I sympathizing? I don't know. They can't have a sympathize with both, because the misunderstanding, like the comedic misunderstanding of, crossed wires where they're going to beat the crap out of each other doesn't work.
And their parents, like, they're so incompetent. Like, you know, they have kids and those are the parents raising the kids. I feel sorry for the kids. Like, they really are incompetent, man.
Well, especially considering how they tried to make the husband of the group a techie who was a database manager, if I remember correctly. And yet,
yeah.
And yet, like, okay, this is another thing I had with the writing that, you know, even though they tried to make the husband, one of the bandits, a techie guy, and yet he doesn't understand any of the tech that's going after him. Like, at one point, the kid has his little German Alexa thing go on, and yet he can't recognize the artificial intelligent voice that's being said. Because I don't care what language it's in. I could definitely recognize an Alexa voice, you know, any day.
Yeah, there's so many holes, man. It's unreal.
or the whole VR sequence, which, well, first of all, they clearly don't know VR. They can suddenly think that you put a VR thing, you suddenly have the same clothes on that in the game.
It's so outside. Dumb. Like, oh, my God.
And yet he doesn't even, he can't even detect or the weight around his nose of an Oculus sitting there or so.
Yeah, it just, like, that part to me was like the most cringy, maybe not the most cringy because a lot of it, but I was just like, this makes no sense. Like, I don't even think this makes sense in 1990. Like, why am I, oh God, you're on the nose here.
It's like I said, they're incompetent. They're incompetent people raising kids. They're trying to get back the ugly doll, whatever the heck it was. I mean, just to think that kids, that they're raising kids. I mean, it still irks me. I'm going to keep saying the same thing. So.
Okay. But yeah, even if they've been smart characters, the way it's done is still really bad, because even though it was clear that they wanted to try something different by having it so that you were supposed to sympathize with the bandits, the script is still very it's very clung to the original Home Alone that it just doesn't feel like it can really differentiate that much. So like Anthony was saying, it tries to have its cake both ways, you know, with the kid and the bandits. And you need to pick a side. You either need to, make the bandits sympathetic, but the kid truly evil, you know, or like the original one, you just cannot do it both ways.
Yep. I mean, they even wasted like Buzz in this movie. They bring him back just to make him even more incompetent than the freaking robbers.
Like, he had no point. That was one of those cameos. Yeah, that was shoehorn him in for the nostalgia factor.
But it should have just been a cameo, not keep showing him. And every time you show him, like, he's worse than the last scene. Come on, man.
Right. And especially because they give him no resolution. He just disappears after he drops that dressing all over his chest.
That was disgusting. Like, honest to God, the littlest things bug me. But he's, what was it, a sandwich or a big burger? And he's getting it all over his jacket and is dripping. And I was just having
like,
oh yeah, I was just that kind of stuff just gives me, it's just traumatic for me. I don't know why. Like, it's my worst nightmare to get something on my shirt when I'm out in my car or something. But he didn't care. Just the lack of even common decency for your own body. Just like, so gross, man.
Well, again, I think he was filled in just to fill in another plot hole on why calling the cops wouldn't work here this time around. And I don't necessarily mind bringing back the original cast to try to connect it, but all they do with him here is just to fill in another plot hole. And yet he just, as you said, he just disappears again. And nobody ever references him. There's no other references to the McAllisters at all, other than a little McAllister home security sign that's up at a few homes that at least indicates that Kevin's there somewhere, but the movie's so incompetent, they couldn't even get a cameo from Macaulay Culkin, who, you know, I know he would have done it, because I don't know if any of you have ever seen the Angry Video Game Nerd video on YouTube where Macaulay Culkin played a bunch of Home Alone games.
Oh, yeah, that was awesome.
Yeah, but he probably wouldn't have done it after reading this script. I mean, they should have just left the little security sign. That's it. That would have been the cameo. That would have been perfect. You don't waste any like nostalgia characters from the past. It would have been better if they would have done a reunion, like everybody catching up or whatever, and not having to go like, you know, robbers and this whole crap. Like, just show them as grown-ups. Just have a Christmas movie with them as grown-ups with nothing to do with the original plot. It would have been a lot more interesting than whatever this is.
Right, because I will say that even though Buzz's scenes are, you know, almost pointless, I did get a little smile as soon as I saw him there, because it was at least nice to see where this character was. And again, it's just sad to see that this is the one guy that they got in that they could get.
I got a bigger smile when I saw McAllister home security system.
Yeah, exactly.
Because that made sense to me. Like Kevin would have gone into that after his experience. So that made me laugh. That actually got a real smile for me in this film.
Well, it was nice to see. I mean, like you, Robert, I got a nice smile out of that. But to watch the light turn on in my kid's head, because they seen the name and they said McAllister, and then they it pans back to his face again. They're like, is that Buzz? And I'm like, yep. They're like, oh my God, that's cool. So that was like one of like the redeeming parts of that film, I guess. But the rest of it, but me and my kids, we did like that part. Once they put those two things together, it was cool to see Buzz's brother. But again, he was wasted. I don't even know how you would have fit a Macaulay Culkin cameo in this. Maybe, I don't even know, some kind of quick, him selling the device. Like, I don't know. Like I don't even know how you
fit. Salesman or something.
Yeah, something like that. Or like even like just the dad and the mom coming from England and then just sitting at a table for a minute and you just see somebody turn around and he turns around in his chair and it's Kevin. So I hear you're looking for security systems. And then it just pan back to the family and be like, yes, we are. And then just leave it at that. But I have no idea.
You know, what would have been good at the airport, like have him at the airport, just crossing, hey, like looking for his kid. Oh, no, you're here. Like something like that, you know, 3 seconds and, you know, that's it. Just have him.
Yeah,
don't involve him in anything whatsoever. Like he's making sure that he grabs his kid before he goes on, you know, to the terminal. That's it. Something 3-second-ish. Don't waste this cameo, especially on this garbage.
Yeah, I mean, they could have at least gotten a Catherine O'Hara cameo somewhere. Like, I don't know if have you guys seen that new commercial, Catherine O'Hara just running around shouting for Kevin?
Yeah. I saw that for the first time the other night, and I had the biggest smile on my face.
Me too.
Yeah. How cool would it have been if you would have had Catherine O'Hara at one of the airports, also running around the airport shouting, Kevin, Kevin.
It'd be like Kevin's mom has a slight touch of dementia. It would have at least
made me laugh.
Yeah.
But yeah,
now I want to go watch part one and two. Jeez.
Yeah, but what's weird, though, is that for a movie that's clearly trying its hardest to get every kind of laugh out of you, I think I only chuckle like maybe once or twice. I mean, does anybody here have any other moments in the movie that that you would at least in that did get a laugh out of you?
I remember there was like two or three parts that made me laugh, not laugh genuinely, but just kind of like chuckle. But I can't remember exactly which parts it was. I'm going to try to remember. But if anybody else goes, it might be the same one. But I do remember like seeing something and was there a part with like a really heavy ball or something? I forget. I don't know. I'll think about it. You guys talk and I'll see if I can remember.
Yeah. So there is a part that made me laugh and not because it was funny, but because it was funny and I can't believe they're doing this type of way. This is so freaking dumb. What is this movie? And it's the end where the little kid throws the upside down face doll down the stairs and mom and dad both launch themselves for it while What Christmas Carol is blaring in the background and as they're going in slow motion. And he bumps into the stairs, she trips and falls into the wall. And oh my God, it was the stupidest thing. But I wish there was a camera on me and Sarah as we were watching it because we both were cracking up at how freaking dumb this is. Like, we couldn't believe it. We could not believe it.
Let's just say that as soon as I saw that scene, the one thing it was missing was like Schwarzenegger from Jingle All the Way, like, you know, flailing in slow motion, trying to catch the same doll or so.
Yeah. He's got two balls.
I'm not a pervert.
Where's your Christmas spirit?
The part that I think that made me laugh was when, you know, he's explaining that he was afraid because they thought that they were calling him the ugly one and that they were going to send him for $200,000. And that part was kind of funny.
This kid. Okay. Was this kid supposed to be smart or dumb? Because at some moments he was supposed to be, they made him smarter than his actual age. But then like he goes to the church. He's clearly 8 years old. He can read. He doesn't see it's a charity drive. Oh, where's the shopping cart so I can take these toys? And then the plot of this movie, this kid literally thinks he's being sold into slavery to a bunch of old women.
Which I will say, I mean, not only did they do that really odd cutaway to that sequence where he's being handled by all those little old ladies or so, which I think they confused Home Alone with A Christmas Story for a moment, or at least the writers did. But again, as I was watching that scene, I actually almost got a Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey vibe, thinking back to that nightmare that Bill had when he was about to be kissed by his grandmother. I thought,
put that together. That's funny.
Because if anything, what this movie needed was a whole like sequence where this kid's just sent to his own personal hell, and you know all those visions that he has it would have at least been explained a lot better. So,
you know, the only good thing about this movie is that we're actually just bashing it right now.
Exactly,
that's the best part about this movie.
I made a comment in the Discord. I'm curious if you guys agree. I think this is one of the worst things that Disney Plus has made for original content.
Yep.
I pretty much have no argument against that. Because I can't even imagine how much more worse press this movie would have gotten had it actually gotten a theatrical release instead of a Disney Plus release.
Oh, goodness gracious.
What I made you? My feelings on Disney very clear in Discord. But for our listeners out there, I think it's further proof that Disney as a whole has turned very lazy and is creatively bankrupt.
Yep. We had an argument about this. I disagree, but we won't get into it here.
But yeah,
Disney. I mean, they have Marvel, and hopefully Marvel, but Marvel will lose its edge somehow because you could actually see it. I don't know how they're gonna come in this new phase or whatever after everything that's gone on. But like Star Wars, it's 50-50 right now. But Disney Creative, Anthony, I know you agree with me. I'm nervous about Hocus Pocus too.
Sorry, Robert, I told you we were gonna get carried away a little bit here.
That's what he planned out for 4-hour podcast.
At least as long as I could, but yeah, I can actually see what you mean that even under the best of circumstances, I just don't even know if Home Alone or Home Sweet Home Alone. I will have to say too, I hate the title Home Sweet Home Alone.
Me too.
Honestly, me too.
Because again, that just feels more like a marketing gimmick. Because when I initially saw that title, I thought that was like a tagline for the movie, not the actual movie title itself.
You could have just named it Home Alone something.
Home Alone 2021. I don't know.
Yeah. Home Alone New Adventure or something. I don't know, because they're moving back. I don't know. Something or different. But
a very Home Alone Christmas.
I don't think anybody even calls it Home Sweet Home Alone. They're just like the new Home Alone movie or something. Yeah, it doesn't have a good ring to it.
Because the other thing I think I will say too, that this movie also wanted to separate itself from the other Home Alone movie as well. It really, really shouldn't have shoehorned in a lot of the other tributes to the movie as well. I think we can all agree that the score to the original Home Alone is probably one of John Williams' best works, right?
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely. Yes, I think it
definitely.
I think it's one of the best Christmas soundtracks, period.
Yeah. So how awkward is it when you do get those music cues and yet it does not match up at all to the new soundtrack?
They don't feel like the way they used the musical cues made the music crappy, in my opinion. Like somehow they took the magic from that music because the music doesn't match the scene. The music doesn't evoke any type of nostalgia for me the way they used it in this film.
One time when it first started and nothing had happened yet.
the only time it actually did for me work, the music, was the battle plan, the battle where he's planning the montage.
Yeah.
The battle plan montage.
Now I have a question.
Sure.
Is it just me? I mean, I know other people, like if you're going to go traveling for Christmas, do you over decorate your house the way like they did theirs?
No, I don't decorate when we go up to Canada for Christmas.
Because that was even a plot hole they did cover in the first Home Alone. Because even though it was a little decorated, the family had clearly had just not decorated at all. But then, when Kevin was home alone, he did his own effort to at least make the living room look Christmassy.
Yeah. What a classic scene when he's looking in the green bulb and he sees Harry behind him.
But yeah, it's just another example on how this movie just had thought put into it, but 100% the wrong kind of thought. Because I will admit there's one of the scene that I was kind of hoping would make me laugh, but didn't, was when he did that remake of the Angels with Filthy Souls in Space thing or so, where they repeated it line for line. And then you had that one actor. Tim Simmons suddenly look at it and go, why are they trying to remake the classics? And I'm like, oh, no, you don't get to say that here.
Yeah, buddy. Yeah. I remember that.
It was part, like, yeah. They were trying to be like, hey guys, we're self-aware, ha ha ha, but come on.
Yeah, because I don't know. Because not only do I hate that aspect, to me it's like when a second movie of a sequel just flat out admits, oh, they say the sequels is never as good as the first, which to me, that's your kiss of death of any kind of movie, when you just flat out admit that.
That worked for me in Scream 2.
Yeah, but that movie was meant to be a parody, though. One giant parody. Because even in Scary Movie, when the original tagline said no sequel, the second tagline for the Scary Movie 2 was "We lied." That was all just meant to be satirical, and yet, you know, when you have we had Tim Simmons, you know, just saying all the remakes is never as good as the first. That to me is even the movie being self-aware of. Yeah, we're only doing this just for a quick cashing on the name because
Disney. Well, they made their cat. They already confirmed Home Sweet Home Alone 2. So
did they?
Are you joking?
Why?
I'm joking. I wanted to see your
reaction. My god!
Oh, I was gonna cancel my Disney Plus.
Is that what the comment there? Like, you have these people like get in a writing room, and then you have the producers, and once this is being made, I mean, I guess you can't change the plan too much, but they had to have watched it after and been like, this is a colossal piece of garbage. Because how could you possibly watch what they put together and think it's good? I don't know what was going on, like in the writing room and then in production and post-production. Like, they must have known it was bad. So they must have polished it up as good as possible, but they couldn't have felt good about it when they watched the final.
It's like Julia said on our podcast, she made a note, it may be the case of too many cooks in the kitchen type thing, where you have so many talented people involved that it just turns into a crap show.
They probably could have just said, hey, listen, we want as many people in on this as we can because we want to do the original justice. But yeah, there becomes a time when there's too many people involved, too many ideas. But you also don't just want one person on a sequel because that could be very narrow-minded. So maybe, I mean, they had a few, right? But it just didn't work out, man. You're obviously not going to cancel the thing when everything's been paid for, but I think they made the best that they could out of it. But I think they need to stop with the sequels Disney-wise anyway, unless it's Coco, because I would love a Coco sequel.
Yeah, they could pay homage to these movies like with something completely different, but yeah, not try to redo, you know.
Yeah, this is why I've always wondered exactly, because Chris Columbus before had said that he actually had pitched another Home Alone movie of Kevin McAllister as an adult, but for some reason they didn't take it, and it wouldn't have been a repeat. It just would have been, you know, telling Kevin McAllister's story after the events of the other movies, which would have been fine because this is a character that I really love following. And yeah, as much as the second one isn't as good as the first, I still liked it just because Kevin McAllister, played by Kevin Macaulay Culkin, just happens to be a fun character I like following around.
Yeah,
this little kid, I just would not want to follow around for 10 seconds. I mean, this is a kid that is just so annoying, so inept. And as Anthony, you were saying, even the film doesn't know if it wants to be, you know, make him smart or dumb or so. Because I will say this too, at least the first movie does establish that Kevin McAllister is at least a little smarter for his age than most kids.
Yeah.
While for this little kid, I mean, again, I feel bad because he was good in Jojo Rabbit, but this is clearly a script that not even, you know, Stanley Kubrick could have saved. You would have needed a complete rewrite from start.
But what you're saying, it's almost a perfect time because we are in a period where they're coming out with these reboots because they're in that sweet spot where everybody from the early, like 80s babies, early 90s are now parents and the parents love the nostalgia. They're in a perfect time where they could make it with Macaulay Culkin as Kevin McAllister with a family and make an idea out of it. And I'm sure it would have been more well accepted than this movie because kids have already, our children or anybody who has kids has already seen Home Alone. So if they were to bring it out as Kevin as an adult, they would still be into it too. Maybe not as much as the parents, but I think people would be more accepting of that than they are of Home Sweet Home Alone, just because we are in a reboot era, but not this kind of reboot. We want to see the originals where they're at now. You know what I mean?
So, okay.
So I have a question for you guys. Oh, I'm sorry, Manny. Just real quick, Manny.
Yeah, this real quick. To have Kevin McAllister back, Macaulay Culkin back, they could have done like, you saw 8-bit Christmas, like he's telling his kid the story of, you know, when he was growing up or whatever. He could be telling, like, his kids might have misbehaved just like the original Home Alone, like he did. And instead of punishing them or whatever, he could start just telling them, just going back and telling them the stories of what he lived. You know,
that was a horrible idea, Manny. And I'm not gonna pretend it was good.
No, I mean, just build up towards where the kids think they're gonna be left, you know, alone or whatever, or the robbers are gonna come, like something with
nostalgia. So you want Kevin McAllister to psychologically torment his children so they don't behave?
Yeah, because no. I mean, he'll tell them the story of when he wished that he was, you know, he never saw his mom again, and where he was, you know, he flew by himself to New York or whatever. Just bringing all that thing back, building up to something else, but have them like interest, you know, bring the people from early 90s and I don't know, like catch up to 2021 or 2022, whenever that movie would take place, but just use the actual nostalgia instead of, you know, making another movie with a complete different kid trying to rip off and, you know, bank out of the idea, which is they made the money, but it still sucks.
Yeah, which, speaking of which, this is one of my other problems with Home Sweet Home Alone once again, that the original movie, even though it's clearly a 90s set movie, it still had a timeless quality that you could pop it on, you know, even today. And because it just doesn't make that many references to the 90s, it's probably one of the reasons why most kids today still get into it. But for Home Sweet Home Alone, there were just so many 2021 references, you know, with the adults doing the, you know, shout out loud hashtags or the use of VR, all that other jazz. Yeah, I just
The VR scene. The VR scene was the stupidest scene in the movie. Where am I? Where did you take me? No, please don't leave me here. So stupid.
And keep in mind that this guy's supposed to be a techie.
Like Robert also said, even if you were disoriented and you had just been knocked unconscious, you're going to feel the weight of this VR system on your face. You're going to feel it pressing. It just made no sense. It was stupid.
Also, they could have done that popular fan fiction that goes around every Christmas on social media about doing adult Kevin, you know, his mom, what bandits break out of jail, go back to the house where his mom is living alone, and, you know, do the kind of reverse. That would have been better than this movie. Like, how would you guys feel? Because you mentioned it, CJ. This is what I wanted to ask before. Like, you mentioned, like, it seems to be a popular trend now. They do it, especially with horror movies, but they just announced a few comedies are going to do it too, where you go back to the original, ignore all the sequels, make a sequel to the original. How would you have felt if they did that? Just going back, acknowledge Home Alone 1, and made a direct sequel to that.
I don't know.
I'm kind of indifferent to that idea, at least for something like Home Alone, because if you were to cut the other sequels out, it really wouldn't have made a difference.
Yeah, that's true.
And wasn't Home Alone 2 like the same idea with a bigger budget?
Pretty much, because even though I'm probably going to do a whole episode on Home Alone 2 at some point, but the whole thing, first of all, even though John Hughes did write it to be set in New York City, a lot of it was because of a contract condition that, since Culkin was living in New York City at the time, his dad had said that the movie had to be mostly set there so that they wouldn't have to do a lot of traveling.
Well, I still agree with Julia. If we go back to our Home Alone 2 episode on our show, to this podcast, for our listeners out there who don't know us, Julia had said that, and I agreed with her, it's almost like the movie should have been flipped. Home Alone 2 should have been the first one and Home Alone should have been the second one. And that's because, like, what are the odds of sticky bandits run into him in New York City of all places? Like, it's almost like that should have been his first encounter with him. They go to jail, get out of jail, and then they target him at the house for revenge. Those movies should have been flipped.
That does make sense. And that, I feel like, out of all the far-fetched things in the movies, I was watching part two the other week. And I mean, even with the law of averages, if you tried to do the math on running into them in New York City while you're on vacation, you're into the hundreds of millions to one, I would say. Like, it's just it's possible, but it's, you probably win the lottery three times before that happens.
Right, because I've only been to New York City, twice in my lifetime, and I kept thinking how funny it would be if, you know, one of my friends from like Seattle suddenly bumped into me right there. But let's face it, that's like a billion and one chance, just like the chances of Kevin bumping into the Wet Bandits would be.
I could totally see Disney making a sequel to Home Sweet Home Alone, though, where they go back to London where they're from for Christmas, and he deals with criminals in the streets of London. I could totally see them doing that. I'm putting money on it right now. They'll do something like that eventually.
I have zero interest.
They could be listening to this.
Seriously, how did they not? They ripped off so much from the first one. How did they not do the Kevin moment and the mom faints? They didn't do the most famous moment from that film.
And not just that, but considering how Catherine O'Hara's journey was actually pretty funny, given how just nuts she went trying to sell her own personal stuff and then just talking to some of the most random people. And not just because, again, one thing that was missing from the movie that I love from the first movie, yeah, is John Candy's appearance as Gus Polinski. Oh, yeah. And yet there's no
Genosha Kickers
like that in the new movie. All we get is just some weirdo guy sitting next to the mom on the plane.
First, when we first met him on the plane, I thought, oh, this is going to be the John Candy character. But again, that was something that amounted to nothing, just like Buzz, his cameo. And like the mom, again, like I don't feel bad for her. It's not a hardship what she's going through. She gets on a flight back home. That's it. She arrives home.
Yeah. Catherine O'Hara trying to sell off her stuff is like, she's a good actress in that scene too. And I always love the old man when he comes back and she's like, oh, and she's got this, and she's got earrings. And he's like, she's already got earrings, long dangly ones. The old man. It's actually funny too. I love the Gus Polinski character. He was just so sweet. And he's one of the only people that you could believe that she could get into a van with and she would be all right, because John Candy was that lovable. Just the Polka King of the Midwest, polka.
Yeah, it's just, you can just see how, you know, the writers, you know, even though they wanted to do a Home Alone movie, clearly just didn't understand anything about the first one that made it so special. Because even just those itty bitty little things, I'm sure you may or may not know this, but all of John Candy scenes, most of his lines are ad-libbed. They're one of the few times they weren't scripted by John Hughes.
I did not know that, but I can see that happening, because he did seem to just go on. And I mean, he's a master at that, right? John Candy is in a league of his own. Good Canadian boy. I always say it. I am one of the biggest John Candy fans, and the fact that he just had this small role in there, man, it was excellent. And to hear,
they only had it for 24 hours.
Right. Yeah.
They only had it for 24 hours.
And you only get paid $400 for that or something.
He did it as a favor. Yeah. And the fact that they only had him, it's the longest day on set, him and Catherine O'Hara, who were friends. They were improv groups and movies together. So like they had that camaraderie already. Like, it's amazing. You could,
I kind of remember tell, hearing like, that now.
Yeah.
It might have been on your podcast, actually. I don't know.
Possibly. But yeah, it's one of those things where, you know, even when I rewatched the first one and then compared to the others, I'm even thinking of missed opportunities they took when it came to shoehorning in. Like, you've heard of that famous urban legend that Elvis Presley is standing behind Catherine O'Hara at the airport, right?
No.
Okay.
I've heard that urban legend, yeah.
And I thought, you really couldn't get somebody looking like Kurt Cobain to stand behind her at the Tokyo airport or something?
Yeah.
Just to fuel another urban legend?
Yeah. You know what would have been a nice cameo in this one, but he was way too old and he did pass away, was Old Man Marley.
Yeah.
Or if like you could have did a cameo for like somebody else, maybe being old. Hey, maybe Kevin was that community's Old Man Marley now. Like, he was shovel the snow on the sidewalk or something.
He looked like them for a point, for a minute there.
Everybody was putting up those comparison pictures to Old Man Marley. And
I don't know what was going on with him then. I'm happy.
He was auditioning for the Crypt Keeper.
I mean, first of all, I will ask, have you met anybody so far that actually liked the new reboot?
Tom.
No?
Tom? It's Tom, though. Tom is like, oh, God.
Tom's the worst.
Yeah, seriously. Like, he just loves to, like, just pick a side that he knows will piss you off and just defend it if he can. That's all he does. Like, even today when he's like, oh, it's not a reboot. Like, shut up, Tom. Go away. God.
So he likes. So the only reason Tom likes it is because Anthony doesn't. So then he actually believes he likes it and goes on with that. Oh, okay.
But yeah, it's clear that Home Alone or Home Sweet Home Alone doesn't seem to be getting that much of a hurrah from most mainstream people either, because we haven't seen any like major praise on it on social media or even within the general press. And
they haven't even made memes out of it. You know, that's how bad it is. That movie's so good. We're talking about freaking Sesame Street over here and Muppets and stuff. So
that's the exactly. thing. Like, if it was getting any kind of good reviews, they blast that stuff via social media. They make it work, and it's not getting any love anywhere that I'm seeing, at least.
It's not getting any attention. It didn't get any attention.
It got like, some attention, but I think they knew it was gonna not bomb, but I just knew it wasn't gonna be well received. I think.
Right. I mean, maybe that
explains the newest Paranormal Activity movie was better than it.
So you're not going to do a deep dive episode on this movie, you're saying, right?
Oh, exactly. This movie
is as deep as we go, the shallow end.
This is that's a lot of attention. Like, the most interesting part about this movie is actually when he uploads this episode.
Probably. I mean, yeah. maybe it's lucky, it might get the kind of fame that The Room gets, where the hate for it is actually more interesting than the movie itself.
Actually, yeah, that crappy Home Alone 3 movie, I find that it is 100 times better than this one.
Oh, here's a fun fact too. Out of all the Home Alone movies, Home Alone 3 is the only of the Home Alone movies that Roger Ebert actually liked.
Really?
Yeah, I swear. If you look at the old Siskel and Ebert reviews of the first two movies, and he trashes on them, but then when he does Home Alone 3, I don't know if it was with Siskel at the time or it might have been with somebody else, but Ebert praised it. He said it was better than the originals. He said he liked the kid, Alex, whatever his name was, better than Macaulay Culkin.
That was during Scarlett Johansson's awkward years.
And to be fair, Home Alone 3, to be fair, Scarlett Johansson already started in her worst movie at the time, and that was that other Elijah Wood movie, North.
Never saw it. I forgot about that movie.
Because never saw it. Yeah, that's the movie that everybody is convinced Rob Reiner only made just so he can go on vacation. And of course, it doesn't help that even though I love Kathy Bates, she kind of has to look at it back knowing that she did herself in, not blackface, but Eskimo makeup or so. So, you know, that
thing. Now I got to watch this.
That thing would just lead to so many people saying, Kathy Bates is canceled.
Oh,
you got to send me the name of this movie. Now I'm gonna have to look it up.
North.
On my IPTV.
Yeah, actually, there's a lot of stars in that movie. Let's see. We got Bruce Willis, Jason Alexander, Dan Aykroyd, Reba McEntire, John Ritter. I know there's a whole bunch more in there too. It was meant to be one of those old school like celebrity filled epic movies, but apparently it tanked at the box office and it almost ended Elijah Wood's career pretty early.
Oh man, I love Reba McEntire as a musician, but I haven't really seen her act much.
You know that the next remake is going to be the Santa Claus.
What?
Are you lying again?
No, I'm theorizing. 100% they're going to remake that film on Disney Plus.
What, the Santa Claus? They should just leave that alone. That's aged well.
No, I think there's a way to make it happen if they get Tim Allen back with Charlie, and then Charlie becomes Santa.
Yes, that what he said. What that guy said in the corner down there.
I don't know. The only way
a remake of the Santa Claus is going to work at all is that you'd have to redo the whole tone of it as a horror movie, because there's a theory that the Santa Claus is essentially a Christmas remake of an American Werewolf in London. Given that the whole characters get their powers unexpectedly and don't want it until by the end they start embracing it.
I would love to see Santa Claus turn into a horror film, but I don't think Disney's going to swing for that.
Well, I mentioned in my podcast that when they did the original script of the Santa Claus, rather than Santa falling off the roof, it would have begun with Tim Allen shooting Santa Claus.
Yeah, and apparently the executives went ballistic or something. Because I like how you get, like, how are you going to do that? Like, no, I can't see that happening on Disney in that setting, I would say.
But
shooting
when they're
Santa Claus,
but when they're in the classroom, you know, the kid actually emphasizes on killing Santa Claus. So that was pretty funny in the actual movie too. So
yeah, that's where some of the dark elements of the original intention probably came out. And I can only assume that back when they had that idea, they didn't have Tim Allen in mind just yet to, you know, play Scott Calvin. Cause I think, going back to my episode, I think that the original idea was to cast Bill Murray, but he said no because he had just done Scrooged, and that was a very troubled production for him, and he just didn't want to do another Christmas movie. And hence,
I thought I remembered Chevy Chase.
Both of them. They even approached Harrison Ford was even on the short list, and that would have been a completely different freaking movie.
That would have been a dark movie regardless if it was Harrison Ford.
But I could see people saying, like, if Tim Allen didn't get it and Bill Murray got it, or Chevy Chase, they would say, oh, I can't imagine anybody else. But I think Tim Allen was perfect.
Hey, like, that's my Santa. Like, that's my favorite Santa out of all of them.
Yeah, he's one of them. I like, can't remember his name now. I'm drawing a blank from Miracle on 34th Street, 94.
Richard Attenborough. Yeah.
Yes.
For me, it's David Huddleston for me.
No, thank you. David Huddleston. I love David Huddleston from Santa Claus, the movie.
Another awful film, man. Me and Robert, we agree on about 50% of movies, I think.
Oh, I'm gonna have to
maybe CJ agree on about 25%, if that.
I mean, my thing is, like, the nostalgia, I guess, with Tim Allen, the Home Improvement, the Toy Story. I don't know. There's something with him. And I mean, like, I guess that Santa Claus is the one that got me back into, like, you know, you could actually still believe in Santa Claus, like, around when that movie came back. Like, I was getting that Christmas magic back. And that's one of the movies, or the movie that puts me back, you know, like, back. I could play, like, that's the other movie that I actually do play a lot. I got to see on Disney Plus how many times I've played it. I don't know if there's a way of finding out how many times I've played Santa Claus, but, and it's the
definitely
first
one of those. It's definitely one of those movies you'll put on, even if you know you're going to sleep, just as background noise, just as for peace and just relaxation.
It's
definitely one of those. That movie was filmed 15 minutes from where I lived.
So you mean you mean like the entrance to your house? Because apparently you live like really, really far down there.
No. I live up north, but at that time I lived in a place called Mississauga, and it was just outside of Toronto. But they filmed a lot of that in Oakville, which is about 12, 15 minutes from Mississauga. And they filmed, like, a lot of it was on Lakeshore. If you look when they're at a Denny's, there's a beer store in the background. There's no beer stores really in the States. It's actually a brand, the beer store. I'm pretty sure it's just Canadian, but I've been to that beer store, but it's gone now. But it's another connection for me, because knowing it was filmed so close to me, and being able to, like, I noticed the highway he's going on when he's lying about traffic. Like, I know exactly where it is. So anytime I take that exit, I'm just like, it's one of those things. You have different connections with movies. I remember my brother loved Home Improvement.
Home Improvement.
So when he was a kid, he'd always call, he would just call the show Tim Toolman Taylor. So back when my brother was two, because he was born in 94, we had the VHS. So every day, all summer, I was babysitting. I must have watched Santa Claus every day that summer. It always reminded me of my brother. And I'll always invite my brother over at Christmas. I said, we're going to watch the Santa Claus. So now it's a bit different. We'll have some beer, some pizza. And like you, Manny, I love that. And I love how everybody has a different reason as to why a certain movie is like it for them. That's why for me.
Yeah, that's exactly why it was for me for the original Home Alone. And that's just something I would always rewatch. And, you know, with this Home Sweet Home Alone, it was obviously not going to recapture that magic. And it's clear that it's probably not going to capture any kind of magic again for anybody else. Cause, you know, one of the things that we all tend to forget too, was that when Home Alone opened, it opened against Rocky V, and everybody thought that Rocky V was going to beat it out at the box office.
Wow. I totally forgot about that. Really?
And did this one little Christmas movie somehow just beat the crap out of Stallone that weekend, considering that most people tend to agree that Rocky V is the worst of the whole bunch.
It absolutely is. It's not even close.
Yeah. I have a question. Going back to Home Sweet, whatever the crap that movie is, did they make any Little Nero's references in that one?
Not that I recall. But...
So they actually missed that. That would have been freaking... Because they're making a lot of money now out of the freaking Little Neros. I guess independent stores, like for ornaments. I've seen hats. I've seen shirts. I don't know if it's actually, you know, from the copyright from the movie or it's just independent people, but I've seen so much crap from that.
Yeah, that's the original chain that was made for the movie. And I also thought, how funny would it be if somebody was flipping through the channels, like they then hit to like MSNBC and then they cut to the like CEO of Little Neros and it's the same pizza guy as if he got to really climb that whole ladder. That would have been another funny opportunity to cameo.
That would have been awesome.
Home Sweet Home Alone sucks.
Oh, wait, are we still talking about that movie?
Yeah, we are. We're crapping all over it, bro.
But I will say, at least having you three guys on this episode was a lot of fun. Thanks for coming on.
Oh, thanks for having me,
Robert. Thanks for having us.
Thanks.
It was great to be here. Having us.
Yeah,
I've always liked your podcast, man. And I'm sorry you had to deal with me, Manny, and a little bit of Anthony, too.
Speaking of which,
hasn't everybody in the past few months had to deal with us three?
I think so.
We're single-handedly giving the Christmas podcast name a bad name.
Well, speaking of different podcasts, who wants to plug in their own show?
I'll do mine first because I
you don't have one, so excuse me, CJ. I'll go. I'm still trying to upload stuff.
Aren't you the same guy that said I was going to do a podcast every day till December, and you lasted one day?
All right, so my name is
Manny. This is Manny.
My name is Manny. I have Feliz Christmas, Merry Navidad, the bilingual, multilingual Christmas podcast. I do not stick to my Christmas word. I say I'm going to do something, and then right then and there, I skip it. I am going to have as many episodes as possible from now to Christmas Day. I will have Christmas surprises. I don't say it on mine, but yes, I will go to Colombia next week and I will be recording and sharing a lot of Colombian Christmas stuff. So, you know, that's a good promo for my podcast. And yeah, CJ used to have Christmas conversations. It's not important anymore because, you know, he gave up on us. So Anthony, plug your podcast.
I formerly used to have Christmas conversations. I took a break. I'm going to be back in June. I'll re-upload all my episodes. I love Christmas podcasting, but I'm naturally an introvert. And the buildup to having to do a podcast like myself and do an interview, it was almost like torture. So I'm going to alter it a bit and maybe add a co-host so I don't feel so stressed about it.
Okay,
so
CJ, I'll do it. You don't have to. You know, as long as you're editing, I'll do it.
Your podcast is bad enough on its own. But I'll be back in June. And it'll be altered a bit. So all the weight isn't on me. So I can share the load a bit. So that's about as open as I'll be about it. But I was getting a lot of good feedback, which was great. I just needed to take a break from it. So I'll be back in June on Leon Day again. And I appreciate everybody who listened. And I appreciate Robert for having me on today, man. I love your podcast. And Anthony, what about you?
I am one of three hosts of Tis a Podcast, a podcast determined to keep the Christmas spirit alive 365 days per year by covering different Christmas movies and television specials every Monday. I'm one of three co-hosts along with Tom the Worst and Julia the Best. And until Christmas, every Thursday, you'll hear a chapter of the Christmas book I wrote, Another Christmas Story, which Robert, CJ, and Manny have all lent their voices to. So thank all three of you gentlemen.
All right. And as all my listeners know, I'm Robert, obviously the host of Behind the Bells, where even though I have not kept to my word of getting an episode out every week myself, from this point on, I definitely am. Because currently, as of this episode, I just put an episode out on an editorial episode out on both of the Doug Christmas specials. And I have part two of Krampus coming soon. And then I have new episodes coming up that are going to go into the deep histories of Santa Claus, the movie, and Die Hard.
Nice.
Sounds fun. Yep. Not a Die Hard guy, but I'll listen for you, Robert.
Awesome. So... Obviously, I hope all your listeners enjoyed this episode, and we will see you again next week. Until then, take care.
Thank you for joining us on this sleigh ride into the magical world of Christmas movies. Check us out for weekly rides into your favorite Christmas classics and their histories. Be sure to give us a positive review on iTunes if you like what you heard. And don't forget to follow us on social media on Facebook and Instagram for updates and special news. Consider subscribing on Patreon in order to help keep the show going and to gain access to some special gifts not available to the public. Merry Monday to all, and to all a good night. See you next week.
Cut. Okay, everybody, that's a wrap.